stand and worship together?
Your holy name. worship your holy name. My heart's
Your name above every other, Jesus, your I'd like to thank you all for showing up today. I know for those who are coming from outside of town, It was probably very difficult to be here. It was difficult for those of us who are in town to get here as well. But not for the same reasons. Last week, we were in the book of John, and we talked about John chapter 20. We were talking about Jesus appearing to his disciples and appearing to Thomas, because Thomas wasn't with them when Jesus initially appeared to them that first Sunday resurrection evening. And we talked about that, and the idea was that we are to believe in the name of Jesus and have life in his name. And if you read the book of John and you come to the end of chapter 20, you think, well, wow, that should be the end of this book. It just seems like, verses 30 and 31 says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. And so it just seems like, wow, okay, let's be done with the book of John. But then there's another chapter that comes in here. And so we get another account. And the scholars have differing views on why this is. But just to put it out there, the idea seems to be that there are a lot of unresolved things within this book here. And one of those things would be, you know, what happens to Peter? Because, you know, he had denied Jesus. Jesus appeared to the disciples there, but you don't really get the restoration of Peter, which we know takes place in John chapter 21, where Jesus asks him three times, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And Peter had denied Jesus three times before, so this was seen as restoration there. If you go in our Bibles, if you go right out of the book of John, and then you go into the book of Acts, and you start reading about what happens in the when the church is birthed there on the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem, you see that Peter is the guy who stands up, and everyone kind of listens to him, and he seems to be the leader. And it's like, well, why does he get to lead? He was the guy who denied Jesus there. And so there's some resolution that takes place here and helps us to see how that came about. I think it's important for us also to see, I think God gives us this because he wants us to know about his grace. He wants us to know about his forgiveness. And if you've ever drifted in your walk with the Lord, it can be very difficult. And what I mean by that is it's hard to believe that God is as good as he is, that he forgives, and that he will take us back to himself when we've drifted from him. And I say that because there was a time in my life when I did drift from the Lord. You know, I was in my college years, early adult years, and I was a Christian. I had walked with the Lord, and I decided I wanted some of the things of the world, and so I got caught up in that for a while, and then it became, you know, like, does God forgive me? You know, can he take me back? Oh, and if we don't understand grace, we might believe, yeah, he can't take us back. But if we understand that he can take us back, and he does take us back, that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to purify and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, then we know that this is the work of God. And so I think it's important to look into this chapter, and that's what we're going to do today, because we want to follow after Jesus in love, because that's what we're supposed to do. So follow the Lord Jesus Christ in love, and know that you can do that because he has died for your sins. And if you come to him asking for forgiveness, he will forgive you of your sins and he will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. We were, I was reminded of that this week when someone talked, and he talked about 1 John 1:9, and he was mentioning how, if you look at that verse, it says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So the idea is that we remember things that we've done. We have sin in our lives that we can confess to God. But not only does he forgive us for that, but all unrighteousness as well, when we come to him and ask him for that forgiveness. So it's an encouragement to us to know that our God stands ready to forgive us, and he wants us to follow him in love. So turn with me to John chapter 21, which is where we're going to be this morning. We're going to go through this chapter, which has 25 verses. And if you've been around, you know that that's a big chunk of scripture to take, but I think we can get through it, and I will do my best to keep us on time. So here we go. You ready? All right. After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, which is the Sea of Galilee, and he revealed himself in this way. Simon, Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, do you have any fish?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they are not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved therefore said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. When they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place, with fish laid out on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dare ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go." This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after saying this, he said to him, "Follow me." Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following them, the one who had been reclining at table close to him, and said, "Lord, who is it?" "Who is it that is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, "Lord, what about this man?" Jesus said to him, "If it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? You follow me." So the saying spread abroad among the brothers that this disciple was not to die. Yet Jesus did not say to him that he was not to die, but "If it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you?" This is the disciple who is bearing witness about these things and who has written these things, and we know that his testimony is true. Now, there are also many other things that Jesus did. Were every one of them to be written, I suppose that the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. And this is the word of God. So the disciple whom Jesus loved is John, and he's the one who's writing this, and he identifies himself that way. At the end, it says, this is the disciple who is bearing witness about these things. Who has written these things, and we know that his testimony is true. And historically, we know that John lived a ripe old age, unlike the other disciples who suffered because of Jesus. And he lived this old, lived his life and died in an old age. And this is what he's bearing witness to as he's writing the book of John here. And they know that it's true because he's still alive as he's writing this book and leaving it to them. And he and other people would know that too. They would also know probably by the time this book was written that Peter had already been crucified or suffered a martyr's death. The tradition has it that Peter was crucified, and because he felt that he was unworthy, he said he didn't want to be crucified the same way as Jesus, that he should be crucified upside down. And so that's the tradition that we have too. And this goes along with verse 19, where it says, "This he said to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God." Verse 18, where it says that you will stretch out your hands and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go, is being seen as this death that Peter died and Jesus had foretold it. Okay, so going through those few things at first, I just wanted to do that because I'm not going to spend a lot of time with them as we get through the text, okay? So follow the Lord Jesus Christ in love. And my first point here is, once I can get that to come up here, is that as we follow, what it means to follow Jesus in love is that we obey Jesus, okay? We obey Jesus. So that's the first point, and we are going to get that, right there. We obey Jesus, okay? Very simple. We obey Jesus. When we talk about following Jesus, okay? If I told you to come follow me on the highway as we drove someplace, if it was in San Francisco, you would stay very close because the highways are crowded there. And there are some maneuvers sometimes that are very difficult to get to. One time I was following someone, he said, "Follow me." And you come off this one place and you're coming from, it's an overpass where a highway meets another highway. And it's not like our highway here, junctions there, but it's moving. And so you take this big sweeping turn and you come down off this ramp and you're coming into the left lane. And the next turn off is in the right lane. So you got to cross five lanes in like a quarter mile, you know, and you're doing 65 at least. And there's traffic coming that you can't see until you come down. So I was following this guy, and he said, "Follow me." And he comes down, and he sweeps into that, and he takes that first turn after we get to the next highway. And I'm, whoa, boom, you know. And I didn't crash anybody, but it's very hard to follow under those circumstances. So we talk about following people, you know, and you're talking about following Jesus. You know, when we think about the disciples, he called them, and he said, "Come, follow me." And we know that they dropped their nets or whatever they were doing, and they followed him. Okay? But he also calls us to follow him too, right? I mean, he after he was resurrected and he appears to the disciples, he tells them later on, he tells Peter, "You follow me." So what does that look like? Because Jesus ascends into heaven, you know, within what? 50 days of his 50 days until, or even less than that, from his resurrection. So what does it mean to follow him? We're supposed to go up to heaven and float up there like him? So we obey him. That's the first idea, okay? And come follow Jesus in love as we obey him. It says, after this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he revealed himself in this way. So he's there, his disciples were there, and Jesus shows up. And it says that there are seven disciples. It doesn't say seven, it just lists them off, and you put them together, and you say, oh, there's seven. Seven disciples that are there, and it tells you who they are. And some of them aren't even named. And it says that they're together, and as they're together, Peter says to them, "I am going fishing." And we talked about this in Sunday school. Some of the commentators would say, oh, they're going back to their old way of life. Well, first of all, they're in Galilee where Jesus told them to go. So in that sense, they're being obedient to him. And to say, well, they're going back to their old way of life, I'm not so sure if that's the case. You know, they're back there and they're waiting for Jesus. He told them to go to Galilee. And now what do you do while you're waiting? Let's go fishing. That's what we do. We still got to eat, right? So they go fishing, okay? And so they say, Peter says, I'm going fishing. And they said, we will go with you too. And so they went out and got into a boat, but that night they caught nothing. And so they go to what they know to do, and they're unsuccessful. And you have an account of this where this had happened earlier in Luke chapter 5, where they had fished all night. And remember, Jesus says, oh, you know, cast out into the deep and throw your nets there. And it's like, really? We fished all night. Now we're going to catch fish? And so Jesus told them to do it, and then they caught fish. And Peter was there. And so here it is. They didn't catch any fish there. And now, as the day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. So you have the picture. Jesus is there. He's on the shore. The disciples are out in the boat. They don't know that it's him, but they see some guy out there, and he's on the shore. And Jesus calls out to them, and he says, children, do you have any fish? That's the literal translation. It can be more like, hey, guys, you got any fish, guys? You know, something like that. It's not necessarily, you know, little children there. There are different words to use in that. And one of the things that John does in his account here in the book, in the gospel here, is that he uses lots of different words. He uses different synonyms. And sometimes we put a lot of stock in that, in those words. And I'm not saying there isn't a place for that, but I'm saying a lot of times it's just style. You know, you try to write things differently because sometimes you don't want to say the same thing over and over again. So if you're talking about someone, you would say, oh, this person, and you'd call them by name, and you'd say, and then this person's name, and then this person's name, and then this person's name, and this person's name. Sometimes you want to change that up, you know. You'd say, oh, he did this, and he did that, and then you would use his name, or you would, you know, call him by something else. You might say, you know, the tall guy that, you know, everybody knew as the tall guy, you know, or the bearded guy, or the big John, you know, if his name was John, and he's a big guy, you know. Sometimes you might say John, sometimes you might say big John, and it's referring to the same person. Jesus calls out to them and says, children, do you have any fish? And they answer him, no. He said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. So they do what Jesus says, and now they have this fish. And as they do that, they're probably reminded of incidents that had happened before. And it says, that disciple whom Jesus loved therefore said to Peter, it is the Lord. Okay? It is the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and he threw himself into the sea. So he's there, he's working, and that's where some of the commentators would say, oh, they went back to their lifestyle, and now he feels a little bit of shame, so he has to cover himself back up to show that he's not really all in on fishing again. And so he jumps into the water. But Peter's not running away from Jesus, he's running to him. And so it says, he puts on his garment, and he threw himself into the sea, and the other disciples came in a boat dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. And so when they got on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place. And if you remember when Peter had denied Jesus, where was he? He was warming himself around a charcoal fire. Okay, so he's setting it up. You know, he's setting up the idea here that there's going to be, this is going to be a place where Peter gets restored. And so they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid on it and bread. And isn't it funny? They go fishing, they don't catch anything. Then Jesus tells them to go and catch fish, but he doesn't need their fish. He already has fish cooking for them. And he's got bread too. But nevertheless, Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught so you can have some fresh fish too. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And I have read things and I have heard sermons about 153, and people do all sorts of things with the numbers, and I don't have anything special for you on that this morning. And I just don't think there is anything special about it other than there's 153 of them, and that's a lot. Okay? Although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. So his first words to them are, come and, you know, have breakfast once they get in there. You know, let's have this meal together. And so He's none of them asked Jesus, "Who are you?" Because it says they knew it was him. They recognized him at that point. And Jesus came and he took the bread and he gave it to them, and so with the fish. And this was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. So John wants to point out that Jesus appeared to his disciples no less than three times. And this is the third time here, according to John's account, when he had appeared to his disciples. Okay? So just saying that here, as he's there, and he sees the disciples, he calls them, they obey him, they do what he's asking here, they recognize it's him, they don't question him as to who are you, they obey. And that's what we're to do as followers of Jesus. We're to obey him. And sometimes we want to question why, and sometimes God gives us an answer. Sometimes he helps us to see why, and sometimes he doesn't. A lot of times when you hear people say something about, like you can go and look at some of the Old Testament dietary laws that they have there, and people will say, well, you're not supposed to put these two things together because then it would create problems in your stomach and you will have digestive problems, or you don't put two types of material together, linen and wool, because if you do that, it saps men of their strength, and so God didn't want them to be sapped of their strength. And they're like ideas like that, and sometimes there's a connection and sometimes there's not. Sometimes it's just to, you know, cooking their meat and blood in the Old Testament was, or with milk, was basically to show themselves as being radically distinct from the idolaters around them who used to do that kind of practice. So he gave them these laws for that, and we can have a reason for it, but sometimes we don't. In this case here, he just tells them to obey him. You know, I mean, he just gives them instructions and they follow it. So when we talk about following Jesus in love, we're talking about obeying him. I know that's obvious, but sometimes it's not obvious. If you ask people if they are Christians, they will tell you yes, but they don't follow Jesus. They believe that there is a God. They believe that Jesus walked this earth, but they do not believe that he is their Lord and their Savior. He's just an idea out there. And there is a difference. So as somebody who follows after Jesus in love, we obey him. Okay? Second point here. To follow Jesus in love is we love Jesus. Right? Sometimes we get into this idea about obeying and we think, well, you know, there's no love in obedience. But Jesus had told us that's how we'll show that we love him, by obeying him. And so we obey and then we love. And this idea about love is coming into what Jesus has to say to Peter. And so he tells him three times, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And Peter had denied Jesus three times. If you look back in John chapter 18, verse 27, it says, 27 is where it shows the culmination there. Peter again denied him. At once a rooster crowed, but starting in verse 17, it says, the servant girl at the door said to Peter, you also are not one of this man's disciples, are you? And he said, I am not. And then a little bit later on in verse 25, and Peter was standing and warming himself, so they said to him, you also are not one of his disciples, are you? He denied it and said, I am not. In verse 27, finally, the third time, he denied it, and then the rooster crowed. So you know that. You know that. And so Jesus asked Peter, do you love me? Okay. After they finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? And so the question is, what is the these referring to? And so there are basically three options in that. There are these. Do you love me more than you love fishing gear? Okay. Do you love me more than you love these disciples? Do you love me more than these disciples love me? Okay. So those are the three options in there. And commentators take different views on that. Okay. The these is not clear as to what it's referring to. I think it's referring to, do you love me more than these disciples love me? Because Peter had basically said he loved Jesus more than all of them when he said, it doesn't matter what happens. I'm going to lay down my life for you. I'm going to die for you. When Jesus said, they're going to strike the shepherd and the sheep are going to scatter. And so that's the idea there. If you say, do you love me more than the fishing gear, is talking about, well, are you going back to this way of life? And that's what some commentators and some preachers have preached that. And you've probably heard sermons like that. Okay, I'm not here to tell you that that's completely wrong. Just say, I don't think that's where it's going. I think the idea is Peter being challenged. You said you loved me more than the other disciples. Do you really love me more than the other disciples? More than the other disciples love me. And to even wonder about the question, do you love me more than you love the disciples? Peter denied Jesus, but he's back with his disciple friends here. He didn't deny them, but he had denied Jesus. So that question is valid, but the idea is more about, do you love me more than these? I think he's talking about, do you love me more than these disciples love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Peter didn't say, yeah, you know that I love you more. He takes away the comparison out of it, and he says, you know that I love you. And Jesus does know that. And you've heard, and the different words for love are in here, are two different words for love. There's agape, and then there's phileo, okay? And those are two different words. And once again, I'm going to just say that you can get some things out of that, and there's some preachers who have preached there, and I'm not saying that these guys that you hear on the radio are completely wrong or anything like that. I just don't think that that's the point that's being made there, because at the end, Peter is not exasperated, if you will, about the fact that Jesus asked him the different ways about love. He's exasperated with the very fact that Jesus asked him three times, do you love me? And furthermore, just the idea, you know, when you talk about the different words that are used, are you guys following me here or did I lose you already? You know, you've heard it all, right? Okay, so I felt like I needed to say this because I don't want to trip you up and leave you unsteady. I just want to say that may not be the whole thrust of what's going on here. Because when you see the different pairs of words here, like the two different words for love, and a lot is made out of that. Well, there are two different words for taking care of my sheep, too. And you get that in some of the translations. It says, feed my sheep, or feed my lambs, or tend my sheep. Those are two different words, too. And then also, at the end, where he says, you know that I love you, you know, and there's two different words for know as well. So you got two different words for love, you got two different words for know, you got two different words for sheep, you got two different words for shepherding or taking care of the sheep, too. Right? So if we can go, and I can go four sermons then about the two different words, four different sets of words, and make something out of it. And so I'm just saying that the reason why is that if you have scholars who know the language and they're sharp and all that sort of stuff, and they can't really agree as to the differences of these words, then why would we as quote-unquote lay people, you know, who study the word as well, how would we be able to get that distinction out of it if they can't even do that for themselves and agree on it? You see where I'm going? So I just want to say that the reason I say that is because there are people who tell me things. I have all my commentaries. I have this one and it has this Greek word, and I have this one and it has this word, and I read these commentaries and this one says this. I'm going to tell you, the commentators don't agree. And I might say, am I smarter than they are? No, I know I'm not. I'm just saying, I want to look at this and say, let's be real about this too. Okay? And so that's where I'm saying. Peter was asked three times by Jesus, do you love me? Peter said, yes, Lord, I love you. Jesus said, okay, feed my lambs, tend my sheep, feed my sheep. And so he says these things to him, and it says, I'm up here in Matthew chapter 26. This goes back to where Peter had said that he loved him Even if I must die with you, it says there in verse 35, I will not deny you. And all the other disciples said the same thing. So there's this idea that he had said his love was better than theirs. And in John chapter 13 as well, you get this idea too. And so he had said this, and so Jesus is confronting him with it, not to throw it in his face, but to just say, hey, you know, I'm restoring you here. You say you love me, then I'm going to give you three times to tell me that you love me so that we can kind of wash the past away. Not that it never happened, but the fact is here, I'm restoring you to this. You take care of my sheep. You feed my lambs. You do what I'm asking you to do. And so Jesus' response to him is to shepherd the flock or to tend the sheep and to feed the lambs. And so when you think about Peter, did he get it? He did get it, because we see a little bit later on in 1 Peter, his letter that he wrote, we see that when he's talking to other people, he's talking to other elders in the church, people who are shepherding the sheep, he tells them this. He says, so I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder. So he's not even saying I'm better than you, I'm an apostle and you need to listen to me. He's just saying I'm like you, I'm a fellow elder. And he says, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. He says, shepherd the flock of God that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. So, when we talk about loving Jesus, Jesus says, if you love me, this is what you do. You feed my sheep. You tend my lambs. You shepherd my people. And so, granted, this is given to Simon Peter. Granted, not all of us are called into a vocational ministry, but we are all called into the and commanded into the disciple-making process, into the whole disciple-making deal that Jesus gave, right? He said, you go and you make disciples of all peoples. You baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and you teach them to obey all that I have commanded you. So there is this component to it as well, right? There is this taking care of the things that matter to God. And I want to encourage you, if there are those who haven't gotten baptized, to come talk to me about that. And we can discuss baptism. We can have you up here. We have a portable. We roll it right up here. Be right here. And I dunk you. I don't even have to get in the water with you anymore. It's great. You can do it in the middle of the service. Be baptized. Be a disciple. We know that God gives different people different gifts. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 to 14, or 16, it says, and it talks about what God gave the church. He gave disciples, he gives prophets, he gives evangelists, he gives pastors and teachers. And the purpose in doing that is for the building up or the equipping of the saints to do works of ministry. You know, even though I'm a minister and I minister, not only the minister ministers, right? And so we need to be reminded of that. We're all in this process. We are partners in ministry. We are doing the work together. And some people say, well, I'm not called to that. Well, you're not called to it, but you are commanded to it. So I say that because I want to make sure that we don't lose our focus about what we're to do. And we want to call out Peter and say, well, he's the one that rejected Jesus and did all that sort of stuff. Well, here it is. He loves Jesus. He's going to do what he asked. When we love Jesus, we obey him. When we come and follow him, we follow him in love. And our service is to be motivated by that love for him. It's not always easy to get up for that, but it is the idea that God can give us what it is that we need to love his people and to do his work as we love him. Then he says here to Peter in verse 18, and I read it to you earlier here, the idea about truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted, but when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and another will dress you. So this is talking about the kind of death that Peter would have, and I gave you, talked to you about that as well. And after saying this, he said to him, "Follow me." I mentioned in the Sunday school class this morning that, you know, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was a pastor in Nazi Germany, you know, one of the things he said is that when God or when Jesus calls a man to follow him, he bids him come and die. No. When we call somebody to come to Christ, we say, how about a nice life? How about a wonderful family? How about children who are godly? How about a great job? How about blessings of good health? Jesus said, follow me, right? And wherever we are with him is eternal life. Whatever the circumstances in between or in all of that, it's still abundant life. And so he calls us to that. Follow me. Finally, when we follow Jesus in love, we live to do God's will. We live to do God's will. So Peter turned and he saw. Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following him. So there's John. He's falling behind. And so Peter says, hey, you know, well, you know, you're telling me all of this stuff. You know, you're telling me to follow you. Well, what about this guy? And Jesus says, you know, what does it matter about him? Right? He basically says, if it is my will that he remain until I come. So there we have another promise of Jesus' return. He's going to come. When I come, what is that to you? You follow me. And so because Jesus said that, there was a tradition that got caught up. There are some people misunderstood. And so the saying spread abroad among the brothers that this disciple was not to die. But Jesus, he makes it clear, yet Jesus did not say to him that he was not to die. But if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? And so he says to him, you know, it doesn't matter what other people are doing. It doesn't matter what this guy does. I have a unique relationship with my servant there. What matters is what are you doing with me? A lot of times we say, I don't want to do something because so-and-so is not doing it. And I know it sounds petty and it sounds childish, but you know what? It's very adult-like. And he says, hey, you follow me. You know, it doesn't matter what the circumstances are. You follow me. And so he commands him that way. And Jesus said that he would return again. And if John was here during that time, then what is that? We know that John has since passed on. And so he isn't there for this time. But Jesus said, what if that were to happen? And so we end the book here, verses 24 to 25. It says, this is the disciple who's bearing witness, like I said before. And then verse 25 says, now there are also many other things that Jesus did. So sometimes we ask, why doesn't God give me more than what he's given me to believe? And the answer to that is he's given us enough. You know, even if you were to start writing down all these things, it says the books in all the world, right, wouldn't be big enough for all that he's done. And I guess if you see that Jesus is eternal, of course you couldn't fill that in all the books of the world because Jesus is eternal, right? So having said all of these things, you know, we live to do the will of God. As people who follow Jesus in love, we live to do the will of God. We don't live to do our own will. And it is the challenge, I understand, in our society. But we live to do the will of God. As people who follow Jesus in love, we obey him. It's very basic. But it's what it means to be a follower of him. Right? We live to follow him. We obey him. We love him. And our action, our service is supposed to come out of that love. And for whatever shortcomings we have in that, we can always ask God to give us the love we need. And he can change our hearts and he can give us what we need. So saying all of that, I want us to be true followers of Jesus. I don't want us to play games and say, oh yes, I go to that church. I believe God. I believe Jesus. No. I want us to be true disciples because that's what Jesus asks us to do. He asks us to be. To come and follow the Lord Jesus Christ in love. That's what he wants from us.